Right, so today we're talking about sex, both why sex and sexual selection. Okay? Do you know what this is? It's not a tree.
It's related to a moose?
Yep, it's related to a moose. It's an elk, Irish elk. Anyone know why Irish elk? Around here? They're really big and they're extinct, right? And it's always an example of runaway sexual selection. So they have the biggest antlers of any deer. And it's thought that, like, you know, they'd be just being selected for having bigger and bigger and bigger antlers until finally they got so big they couldn't like walk around in the forest and got caught and died out. Right? And one of the things Gould showed is this is just sort of allometric scaling relationship that if you build a big deer, it gets even bigger antlers, which is this nice steady curve. So they're just on that curve. And so they are extinct, but probably not due to getting caught in trees. So, first some clicker questions to warm us up. It's 40-41. First one's sort of a gimme, I hope. Okay, one more minute. Okay. I'll give you a chance to talk about your answers now, because there's some disagreement in the class. I want you to sort of teach yourselves this. So talk to your neighbor about what the right answer might be and why. And then you can retake it. Right now it's 20% have the wrong answer, 80% have the right answer. Feelings have no place in science. Even Darwin was. He married his own cousin.
He was in the West. He wasn't going off the prior knowledge like we are.
Yeah, he wasn't taught in class the NASA. Yeah. He's also a terrible student. He almost dropped out of school. Yes. Alright, retake your test. Whatever you click it. Yay. People are learning. Alright, everyone satisfied? Okay. So, yes, A and B. Okay. Why not just A? Exactly. So diversification is speciation minus extinction. I said it's two terms. I can make one bigger or one smaller. Good. Any questions about that? Okay. You can't talk about this, there's just like pure recall, right? Have you done the background reading? Wait, 1 minute. All right. Survey says. So, why is it B?
Is this the Venus flytrap?
Right, Venus flytraps eat insects. Why not A? It's ancient, right. So it's Anomalocaris, right? It was living in the Cambrian seas. There were no insects for it to eat. Also, if there were insects, it would have been on land, and it lives in the water. Right? It would have been, yeah. So like a shark getting, jumping out, also flying through time to get insects, okay? Fig wasp, why not fig wasp? Wasps eat stuff. Right, pollinates figs. Yep. And the larvae get the nutrition from figs. Good. And lichen? Yeah. Even insects can get killed by lichen. However, there are fungi that kill nematodes. They have a little lasso, and they have something that attracts nematodes. So the nematode goes through the little lasso, and then gets trapped, wriggles, and then slowly gets digested. Yeah, so that's pretty cool. I mean, fungi. There are also fungi that eat humans, of course, too, right? You can get fungal diseases. But it's, you know, more of a parasitism rather than, like, predation. Yeah, good. Any questions about that? All right. So, class today, learning objectives. Why is sex weird? Evolutionarily speaking, right? Why do you think this is a very weird trait that makes no sense but still very common? Okay. Why has it evolved? How does sex ratio evolve? And how does sexual selection evolve? So here, let's take, you know, two potential species, right? You have, you know, one that has males and females, one that has just females that they reproduce by themselves. This is a population growth rate, right? So if only females produce offspring, you know, these produce, on average, one male and one female, right? Only the females lay eggs. Okay. Here, two, and then each of those have two, right? So the asexual one, you know, has twice as many grandkids as the sexual one, right? I think the being asexual would be a selective trait. Asexual would be a selective trait, right? Because males in this purpose, in this scenario, don't contribute much other than some sperm, right? And so they call it the twofold cost of sex, right? So we have, having half as many grandchildren. Right? Okay. So that's one cost. And so any theory of why there is sex rather than asexuality has to explain how it's so much better than even this cost. Also, think about relatedness, right? So you're not a clone of your mother, right? You only have half of her genes and half of some other guy's genes, right? And if your mother just gave birth to you just asexually, you know, all of her genes would be passed on, right? So why pass on half your genes? You can pass on all your genes. And your genes are in a selection for being passed on too, right? So there's also that cost of sex, you know, from the mother's point of view, okay? It's another cause of, you know, why sex seems like a weird thing to evolve. Okay. Maybe we're just stuck with it. Right? Maybe there's no variation. So, you know, it's like us, you know, maybe awesome if we had wings, could fly around too. There's no variation for wings in humans. We just can't evolve wings, so too bad. Right? So maybe we're just stuck with sex because it evolved a long time ago and we can't get away from it. Right? Well, no. actually, asexuality has re-evolved many times. Many plants are asexual. Stick insects are asexual, some aphids are asexual. Actually, some aphids are born pregnant. And they hatch out their eggs and they're already starting to produce more eggs of their own. Okay. Some bees are asexual, and other things. Okay? So, there is variation then for asexuality and sexuality. So, it's variation. It feels about then if asexuality is adaptive, that has to be selected for and become more common. Right? And actually, what we see in nature, that there are asexual groups. But they are sort of tippy on a tree, such that
you have a tree like that, there might be an asexual group here or here. With a few exceptions, you don't see a large clade of asexual things. Why might that be? What does the sort of tippiness suggest? Oh yeah, possibly you can't speciate, right? But, yep. Okay, so it could be going from sexual to asexual only. Yep. What else? If we're just low speciation rate, you could sometimes see, you know, something that was, you know, asexual for a very, very long time, but it's not diversifying, right? We don't see those either. General. How might that be? Mm-hmm. Right, so higher extinction rate would do this, right? So you could have lower speciation rate or higher extinction rate. Okay. Which helps explain this. Good, so let's talk about what that might be. Okay. First is the term time for getting adaptive variation through the population. Right? Let's imagine a population is lowercase a, b, right? And the optimal trait comes from capital A, b. Right? How do I get there? Well, in such a population, I can have, you know, a, b, and then I have a mutation here where I now have two individuals that have capital B, and here's some individuals with capital A. So, start out with AB, then I have AB and AB, and then I also have that, right, through time. How do I get this? A B, all those, right? It's by your combination, right? Without sex, no recombination, right? So in order to get to here, even if I have both adaptive alleles, big B and big A, in the same population, one has to reach fixation first, and then I have to have a second mutation to get there. So even though they both occur at this population, there's no way for this big B to get with this big A. There's no recombination, no sex. I just use it to kind of re-evolve. That's one thought of the cause for this. Make sense? Any questions about that?
Is there like a name for that?
Benefits of recombination. There's also another thing called Muller's ratchet. So people aren't mechanical anymore, so this is what a ratchet is. Okay. So a ratchet is something that turns one way only. Right? And where have you seen ratchets in life? It's not on your iPhone. If you use a jack or something, it has a ratchet with a pawl. You know, things like that. Anyway, it's a mechanical device, it used to be very common. It can only turn one way. And one thought for explaining for sex is Muller's ratchet. Right? Whereas we have a finite population without recombination, okay, we can eventually lose fitness. Okay? So imagine the black is the optimal genotype. Okay? And occasionally we get mutation here and mutation here, okay, which have lower fitness. Will he disappear from population? Basic pop gen. So, you know, that population has one of these things, so those will disappear.
right, for a neutral mutation, what's the probability of the new neutral mutation, which is fixation? What's the reason for that? Here we have 8 genotypes, okay? 7 zeros and 1 1. If I come back a long time later, I'm going to have either all zeros or all ones. Why is that? If 0 and 1 have equal fitness, and I have no new mutations. Why would I get to use 0, 1 for everything? Genetic drift. Right. So, you know, by chance, this one has 2 offspring, and this one has 1 offspring, 1 offspring, 1 offspring, right? And so I could then get 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1. So the next generation, by chance, this one could have 3 offspring, 1 offspring, 2 offspring, 1 offspring, 1 offspring, 0 offspring. Right? So you have frequencies change your time. Okay. So at some point, it's all going to be all 0 or all 1. What's the chance that it's going to be all 1? Let's simplify it. Setting complexity. Okay. At this point, they're all going to be one of those letters, right? So I'm going to reach translation. So it's just being A versus B. The same, right, so the equal chance, right? So when I get to translation, it could have all been from this one or from this one, equal probability, right? How about A, B, or C, what's the probability? Equal 1/3, 1/3, 1/3, right? How about A through H? So the same, right? 1/8. What's the probability of it being H at the end? It's okay, this seems easy. It's a good easy answer. It's still 1/8, right? So the probability of it being 1 is 1/8. Probably being any of these, this could be A, B, C, D, E, F, or G, right? Total, it's still 7/8. Right? So that's drift. That's fixation probability. Right? Fixation probability is your frequency in the population. Okay? See why that is? Okay? So, in this population, if these all have equal, you know, fitness, probably this one going extinct, becoming dominant, even only one is what? Yeah, if I come back here in a million years having only the red ones, it's probably a that. 1/4. Perfect. Good. Okay. So how does different fish fitness affect this?
If it was lower fitness than the black, then it wouldn't just be drift, it'd also be selected for, so it would be less than we expected.
So it'd be less than 1/4. Is it 0? No. Right. So strictly neutral is 1/4, if, you know, deleterious, it's slightly less than 4, but it's still greater than 0. As well as retro, what happens is, at some point, you know, if every single one gets a mutation, or the deleterious ones become more common, right, there's no going back. Right? So at this point, you know, by chance, this one's drifted off to become extinct, right? And now everyone in the population has at least one mutation. Right? So overall, the individual fitness has dropped. Right? So, found population. So I could, you know, potentially by chance have another mutation exactly the right place to reverse it. Very, very low probability. Right? So this is, you know, 300 base pairs long. Right? And I've changed an A to a G. Because the one with 300 chance will have another mutation right here. Now that one fortune.
Why doesn't it consider, like, if it's per individual fitness, couldn't they still evolve some trait that's not one of those colors but it's still beneficial?
Right, they could still adapt in general. Right. in terms of overall, like, trend, right, for something that's working well now, it's easy to have these delta mutations reach fixation. Is this easier in a bigger or smaller population? Probably, but a deleterious mutation in a small population, such as this effect. So, if you have a big enough population, it's going to happen because this is slightly better. Selection is powerful enough in a huge population to be able to pick it up. A small population, it might work.
Okay. But if we have sex recombination, it's something like this, where if I have this population, right, they all have at least one mutation, every combination, I can have these possible offspring. So what?
It sort of gives you a way to purge the deleterious
mutations. Mm-hmm. Right. So this one right here is awesome. We're back. We've lost both of those mutations. The sibling isn't doing so hot. Yeah. Right? But the population as a whole now we've gone back to the ones that have zero of these deleterious mutations. Okay? So we can lose these deleterious things through this recombination process. Okay? And so this process of, you know, continually decreasing fitness in a finite population size is called Muller's ratchet. Okay? And then we can escape from that with recombination in sex. Right? So this is one of the main thoughts of why they're sex. Any questions about this? Okay, so given this, where do you think sex would be more important? Large population groups or small population groups? Small, right. And so we think in things like bacteria, maybe, I mean, they do some weird gene shuffling and picking up genes from the environment, stuff like that. They typically don't go through recombination the same way that, you know, eukaryotes do. And eukaryotes look at small population sizes. And bacteria can rely on selection, whereas we used to use recombination. Good. Okay. We also then can also create more variation through sexual reproduction, too. Right? You saw that here, where everything here has, you know, 1 to 2. Now we have from 0 to 2. Right, if you're coming in this one, you have 3. There's more variation there. Okay, so here is the analysis with parasite pressure and what happens with sexual and asexual populations. This is a population of things that someone can be asexual, someone can be sexual. Right, so it's a heritable trait, either sexual or not. Low parasite pressures, right, all parasitism, the asexual ones increase the frequency and then they get common enough to die off and then a new one. Okay. With high parasite pressure, the asexual ones get more common, but not as
high and the more dealt faster. So talk to you about why that might be. We'll explain that behavior. You need to admit you don't know what's going on to your neighbor. Yeah. So the first panel has hints here. Good. The first panel has some hints for why this might be going on. All right, 1 minute. All right, so let's talk. So what's the explanation? Why might this be? Explain this. Yeah, like, explain why this has more of these white elements on this. I mean, so, you guys are talking about what's happening here, so why don't you explain that? So you have these asexual ones, and at first they're parasite resistant, right? And so they're going great. So the parasites, those that can eat these asexual ones better, do better, right? And so there's strong function pressure with the parasites, and so the parasites eventually start doing well and start wiping out this clone really well. Why don't we look at the sexual ones? So the wiping out the asexual ones in all the time, they can't evolve fast enough to out of all the parasites. The sexual ones, through this recombination and shuffling of genes and things like that, they can generate more variation. And so more variation means you can have faster evolution. And so they can evolve fast without having lots of mutations, just by having this recombination, this reshuffling of the deck. Yeah. Okay, yeah. So let's just take this line right here.
it's saying out of the population, this fraction is asexual, one clone, and the rest of them are sexual.
Yeah. No, it's the host. It's the host that's sexual. So we have, let's say, let's say we have a group of aphids, say, right? The human population can say, what fraction of them are asexual ones, what fraction are sexual ones? And then come back, a little time later and find out, are not a smaller fraction of asexual, bigger fraction of sexual. That's what it's getting at. But of course, the asexual ones are different clones. So you can have, you could have all your offspring be asexual, and someone could have all her offspring be asexual. So different origins of asexuality. So different clones.
And so at first, if you're a rare clone, you do well, because all the parasites are adapted for most common clones.
Right? Once you become more common, the parasites can adapt to you, right? And the selection pressure adapts to you, and you can't evolve quickly enough to get away from that. So you get knocked back. Okay, with the sexual ones, you can do more variation. So it can do better. Right? But otherwise, of course, being asexual has to do all you didn't talk about. Right? If you have very low parasite pressure, God forbid you become asexual, right? Higher fitness, upward point. Whereas with higher parasite pressure, the cutoff point where it becomes disadvantageous is a lot lower frequency. Does that make sense? Ask questions.
So in the middle one, the different part of the piece aren't really related to each other, it's just that origin is just like maybe more successful than the other origin.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Through stochastic factors or...
So you could shuffle those around and it wouldn't change.
Right. Makes sense, man? Yeah, there's more evidence that, why sexuality would help. Despite its short-term cost, because it helps you escape parasitism. That is some evidence that humans, when we choose a mate, we choose a mate based on those that have different alleles for us, for different immune system genes, right? So that way your offspring are very different from you in terms of your immune system. So you can have this selection for difference to create more variation. So your offspring can escape the parasites that you had. Because you married someone who had very similar alleles, and the parasites that are on you would have a good chance against your offspring, too. Kind of crazy. I mean, even humans are affected by that.
Wouldn't you have to be able to detect that, then?
Yep. So if you take your... So they've done tests where they take, dirty t-shirts of people's, chosen mates and other people's mates, and, oh, this one smells good. Yeah. Or less bad, I don't know. so it's... So humans can, even though we're not very good mammals, humans are, olfactory reception. Maybe even so, we still detect that. That's crazy. Okay. And this here shows something similar with showing if we have inverse relationship between the proportion of males, which is a proxy for how much sexual how much of the population can go into sexual reproduction and parasite load. That's inverse as well. Alright. But there are exceptions. Who knows what this is? It's one of our key organisms. Yep, delayed rotifers. So they would have, some of them haven't had sex for 80 million years, right? Even though they come for their relatives are sexual, right? And so, how can they pull that off, right? You imagine, I just showed you how if you're asexual, you can have parasites evolve and get you, right? This has been asexual for a long time. How could that persist? Yes. How can you escape your parasites? So one thing you can do is you can have variation through sex that we're talking about. The other thing you can do is you can run away. And so what these can do is when their pawns dry up, they can become these dry husks of things that can be blown away all around the world and land somewhere else. And the parasites don't follow them. And so, you know, for a good parasite, it's always getting in new rotifers being blown from somewhere else. So that way you can weird exception that lets them escape parasitism without having to have sex. And so it, you know, can well have all the benefits of an asexual lifestyle without the cost of parasitism. That makes sense? Okay. This sort of shows why in biology we love exceptions. I say, okay, you know, sexuality is an important thing and it leads to, you know, all these benefits. And then if we find something weird like this, we say, oh, well, if that's true, explain this guy. You know, and this is some like little thing that was in pond mud. Care. It's not like you see, like, zebras or something, you see macro evolutionary, you know, macro ecology or macro fauna, right? This helps us understand the mechanisms of evolution. And so this weird exception shows, oh, maybe it's due to, you know, treating parasites, and this has a different way of doing it. And that's why there's sex. Yeah. Yep. I'm not sure about lots. I mean, there are at least dozens, probably more. No, because they're asexual. So then the question is, what's a species in this case? Right? So if, you know, my sister and I, you know, come from the same mother, our offspring are never going to interact with each other again reproductively, right? So are we different species or not? And so that's a whole fight that happens about, you know, what determines. Because we often think about, you know, species are these interbreeding things, right? Biological species concept doesn't apply for asexual things. And so for bacteria, people will always say, okay, fine, bacteria do something different. We'll have some other threshold for, you know, what causes that species. But here we have a metazoan that has this happening too. How are you doing it there? So, and then in various approaches. Okay. So even sex ratio. Okay, so in this class, it's about 50-50 male-female. Right? Actually, in college now, it's probably more women than men. Right? In human population as a whole, it's pretty much 50-50. In most species, it's pretty much 50-50. Right? And how do you get to be exactly 50-50? So with us, we have chromosomal sex determination. Right? So we have, you know, males are XY, females are XX. So on average, the offspring half time are XY, half time are XX, so at least a 50-50 ratio. Right? Is that always the way sex determination happens? No. With the exceptions.
I don't know if this is what you're looking for, but I know some reptiles are really, really temperature sensitive.
Mm-hmm. Right, so temperature sensitive. So crocs or turtles, if you make it warmer, they're going to be more female. And if it's cooler, they're more male. Right? And so presumably they could adjust their temperature threshold such that if it was adapted to have 90% female in the nest, they could just make the nest warm enough that they have 90% female. But if they managed to have 10% female in the nest, they could adjust the nest temperature or whatever the genetic threshold is for becoming male to allow 10%. Right? So there, it's not limited by XY. It could be set to any number between 0 and 1. Right? Even so, in those populations, it's usually 50-50 as well. Okay. So you have this, yeah?
In humans, it's like 1.3 to 1 males.
Right. Yeah, so I mean, so the overall trend is around 50-50, but there are local effects, like, yeah, so males die younger and things like that. Yeah. I don't know. I think the chromosomes are the same because they don't use sex chromosomes for determination. So I'm pretty sure they're all the same, but I'm not 100% on that. Anyone know? Actually, sex chromosomes turn over. So in marsupials, actually, sex chromosome for males has evolved multiple times and lost, and a new chromosome becomes part of it. So it's an interesting process. Right. So we have this basic trend to explain of 50-50 throughout life, despite, you know, being ZW and XY and temperature determination and things like that. So why would that be? And this is due to Fisher's principle, right? So this is my population, right?
Let's add for the fitness of each one of these.
Assuming they're sexual, each one has to have a partner. Right? Let's pick the fitness.
The male fitness is going to be a lot more.
Okay, anyone disagree with that? So why is that?
Because they're expected to have more progeny. Like the top one female is 4 females and 4, but each female is 4.
So let's imagine so 2 males and 8 females, right? So we could have strict monogamy, right?
So we have this pair and this pair,
right? So then each male has reproduced, and only a quarter of the females reproduced, right? Or we don't have monogamy, like most species don't. We could have, you know, this male's with this one, and this male's with the rest, right? And then, if that's the case, then every offspring that comes out has one of these, and only, you know, one. So half the offspring have this father, half the offspring have this father, 1/8 of the offspring have this mother, 1/8 of this mother, and so forth. Right, so whether it's monogamy or just a broadcast of eggs and sperm, right, in either case, the males have much higher fitness than females, right, because there's fewer of them. You require one of each for offspring. Okay? And so, if that's the case, what's the if you have some sort of trait that allows you to have more male offspring or more female offspring, what's being selected for? Females are being selected against, right? So if my next generation I can have, you know, something that makes my offspring more commonly male, then I might have 3 males and 7 females, right? And so still expected to have males up to what point? I mean, if it's 70% males, what's the better gender to have? If it's 70% male, then what at that point what would it be? Female, right? What if it's 60% male? What if it's 49% male? Right? What if it's 51% male? Right. So there's a stabilizing selection for 50-50, right? So even if you have tons of variation for creating, you know, all males or all females or any number you want in between, right, the optimum is going to settle down at 50-50. Right? And so it's something we see in most of nature. Okay. And there are some freakish exceptions that deal with, you know, sibling mating with your siblings, stuff like that, which I'm not going to talk about. All right, sexual selection. So, when we think about sexual selection, we often think about things like this, right? Male-male competition. Right? Or, you know, this, where giant elephant seals go and bloody each other on the beach. Right? and this seems like it's sort of maladaptive, right? So, like, let's show who's fitter by just bleeding each other out. Any better to, you know, have some other trait that leads to, or bash each other's heads in, right? And something that's not going to increase overall fitness of the population. But again, natural selection isn't about overall fitness of the population, it's about individual fitness, right? And so, if I make it so that all other individuals of my species are brain dead with my horns, right? As a species, might do terribly, right? Because we have very few offspring. But I have more offspring than anyone else in the population, so I win. So selection is selecting for those genes. Okay. That's crazy. You can go see those in California. Right? There's also stuff like female choice. Right? So, I'm going to leave Attabaro, who's everyone's choice. We'll get to some cool birds in a second. Yes. So here are bower birds. Okay? And so, the male has built this structure, not for eggs. They don't lay eggs there. It's just a courting room. Right? They created this wonderful area to court females with beautiful dung arranged, and flowers, and fungus, and things like that. Right? And so, a ton of effort being devoted to this completely pointless thing. Right? Just based on something that looks attractive to females, and so draws females in. Okay. Also things like this. So here are Tungara frogs we talked about earlier, right? And they can make two kinds of calls. They can also do meow, meow. Okay. And the click click is tremendously sexy to females, but it's also tremendously attractive to bats. And so if you're a male Tungara frog, you know. Yeah, so that's an example of something where it has this, you know, sexually costly trait, right? So it by clicking, it attracts more females and shows it can survive, right? But it has an increased risk of death. Okay. And so there is various ways that there's sexual selection in different species, right? Some is mate choice. It's like the clicking, like making the bowers, right? Some is contests, right? So like the bighorn sheep hitting each other. Some is coercion, happening things like ducks. Sperm competition happens a lot. Right? Endurance rivalry, right? So you see dragonflies in a pond defending territory, right? They're trying to stay out there as long as they can, you know, and get the females that come by. The males do. The females come in and maybe eat and leave and mate and leave. Right? Males are trying to guard territory and they have to leave to go get food, right? So the only male can come in there. And so they'll lose space. The only ones that are there the longest do well. Bee flies will actually sit there hovering until they finally drop dead of exhaustion. Right? But the guy who stays out there the longest has the most success and the most offspring. Okay. also scramble competition. Right? So for example, when female ants leave a nest, so ants, we don't have wings, right? Well, actually, regular ants do have wings. And so females will leave and fly off, and sometimes a bunch of males will come and swarm her and try to get on her. So the ones that can find the females first, fastest, when in the scrum can reproduce. And those are infanticide. Okay? And so there's all these different ways of having sexual selection. And normally it's the males are getting chosen, right? So the males are, you know, fighting each other or creating bowers to be selected for. On and things like that, or forming, you know, doing crazy dances. Right, why is that? Mm-hmm. Right. So creating eggs and like that, or creating offspring, requires a lot more energy than just donating sperm. Right. And so a female is limited to producing, you know, between 1 and 5 offspring. A male can produce between, you know, 1 and 100 offspring. More variation in male fitness, okay, and lower cost to reproducing over time. So the male can be less choosy in many species. And that's reversed in some species. Some species, males do lots of parental care and make these giant floating nests. In that case, then, the females compete for mates. That's all about reproductive investment. That makes sense? And something like those elephant seals, they've done paternity studies, and a few of the males will sire, you know, almost all the offspring, and most of the males, I mean, it's only 1% of the males will sire all the offspring. Most of the males die virgins. Right? Whereas the females, almost all of them will have offspring. So males, you know, one will have hundreds of offspring. Most will have zero. Females all will have, you know, 2 to 3 offspring. A lot less variation, so a lot of selection pressure. Right? Any questions about this? Oh. I'll see you on Wednesday. Yeah.
When we were talking about the balancing ratio, what about method algorithms? Can some animals have been switched back and forth? Can they like sense the ratio in the population? Like, how does that
No, actually what these humans do is they duel. So there are these marine snails that do penis fencing, right? Because you want to have offspring, right? You don't want to have to pay the cost of raising them.
Yeah.
So if you can inseminate your opponent, then you both have a kid, but he has your kid. Where if he wins, then you... And so...
That's really cool.
Yeah, there's definitely this fencing that happens.
What was that rule you said was the rule of...